The Lord reigns. He is robed in majesty. The Lord is robed in majesty and is armed with strength. Your throne was established long ago. You are from all eternity. The seas have lifted up, O Lord. The seas have lifted up their voice. The seas have lifted up their pounding waves. Mightier than the thunder of the great waters, mightier than the breakers of the sea, the Lord on high is mighty.
Welcome to Majesty. My name is Ron McKinney. I am pastor of Kinsey Drive Baptist Church in Dalton, Georgia. And we do welcome you today to this particular program. This is just before a new year. We're looking at 2015. It's just around the corner. And it's kind of hard for me, especially, to believe that it's 2015. It seemed like yesterday we had a turn in the millennium, and it was 2000, and now it's 2015. I remember we were talking about things that would happen perhaps around 2012 or 13, and it seemed so far off. Here we are at 2015. But it tells us that time moves on. One of the things that we do know is that in everything that happens, God is working His plan and working His purpose in all the events that are taking place. We've seen some real changes that have taken place both in our nation, but internationally, around the world. There are things that are going on, many things that we never dreamed would take place. We have terrorism that we're dealing with that we never dreamed of at one time. Surely we had situations that came up, but it was something that we didn't think would affect us that much. And yet now, it seems like it's an everyday event. And so we're facing a different world than we had, say, 20 or even 25 years ago when I first came here to Dalton. I came in 1990, and it was then that became pastor at Kinsey Drive Baptist Church. A lot of things have taken place in those 25 years. But one of the things that has not changed, and I will tell you this, it has not changed, and that is the gospel according to Jesus Christ. I'm a firm believer in the gospel of Jesus Christ, as it is recorded in the Word of God. I believe in the Scriptures. I believe that it is God's holy Word. I'm beginning in the year 2015. I'm going to be preaching through the gospel as recorded by John. And I invite you to come and be with us in services on Sundays, because I will be going verse by verse, expository preaching through the gospel as recorded by John. It's a very special gospel. One of the things I will tell you about it is that the gospel of John is an eyewitness account as to what actually happened. And John gives a very different, I say different, he gives a more intimate view of the person of who Jesus Christ is. Now, we have the synoptic gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, the three gospels, which really are looking at some of the same events. And what those writers are doing are writing from the perspective that they could see. There's no error. I'm not saying that at all. I'm just saying that they were seeing it from a little different perspective, even the same accounts of what is going on in the life of Jesus Christ. One gives us, like Matthew, gives us the lineage of Christ through the lineage of David. We have all of those people that we see there that were in the lineage, and we can name them, and they were people who were not exactly perfect people. In fact, we have Rahab is in the lineage there. And we think about the fact that there was David, of course, who was an adulterer and a murderer. And yet we see they were in the lineage of Christ in the sense that they were those that were graced by God. And God showed mercy to them. But our Lord Jesus Christ was born of a virgin, and he was not in any way tainted with sin. That humanity that was in the womb of Mary was that which was created by the Holy Spirit. And the second person of the Godhead came and dwelled in her womb. And we have humanity and divinity that comes together, not blended nor half God, half man, but fully God and fully man. In fact, we call him the theanthropic person, the God-man. And I believe in the scriptures that everything's recorded there for us, for our understanding. And God gives to us his Holy Spirit in order that we can understand the scriptures. I'm talking to you today, and I want to ask you a question. Do you have any idea why God made you and why you are here? Just think for a moment. Why am I here? Certainly you've had some thoughts like that because, you know, it's more than just eating and drinking and working and having family and spending time doing whatever leisure you may have in terms of entertainment or whatever you desire. But I'm just saying, what is the purpose for being here? Certainly there is more to life than just the daily routines that we go through. Well, I tell you, the Bible is very clear that we have a calling. And that is, we are to give glory and praise to God. I want you to look at a verse of scripture for me. It's found in the Proverbs. And in Proverbs, we have these very short, but I would say very succinct definitions of various things in terms of what God says we are to do and how we are to live. And there are certain things in the Proverbs, if we take them and we look at them from the standpoint of God speaking to us, he is showing us both how to live, how to come to a knowledge of who God really is, to understand him. And may I say this before I go any further, that in order to understand God, it is necessary for you to be in him, that is in Christ, that you have a relationship with Jesus Christ that comes by the working of the Holy Spirit. As I was talking to you about the book of John, we go back to John chapter 3, and we see there Nicodemus, who comes to Jesus in the evening, and he calls him a rabbi, a teacher. He said, I can tell that you are a teacher sent from God. And Jesus said to him that you must be born again. You must be born from above. You see, the interest is that men sometimes think that coming to God is just a mere change of thought. It's just an assent. Oh, it's far more than that. It is one in which the very nature of man is changed. And let me tell you this, according to the Bible, the nature must be changed before one can believe. The Bible says, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you will be saved. That is truth. I'll tell you that everyone who believes, but that belief is more than just an assent. It's not just a nodding of the head to some particular questions and answers that you may have. It's the fact that God gives you a very new nature. If any man be in Christ, the Bible says, 2 Corinthians chapter 5:17, he is what? He is a new creature. creature, or I like to interpret it in this sense, he is a new creation. He says, all things pass away, behold, all things become new, because he says, because all things are of God. And so God is the one that works and makes in us a new nature. He creates within us the nature in which we now will love the things of God and we will hate the things that are displeasing to the Lord. It makes all the difference in the world, because when we come to serve God and be obedient to God, we cannot do it unless we have a nature that desires to please him. Man is in such a condition that he's not able to do that. The natural man cannot receive the things of God because they are spiritually understood. You must have the working of the Holy Spirit. But let's look at this verse of Scripture. It's found in Proverbs. Proverbs chapter 4. Now, I'm going to read a little more of the passage here than just verse 23, which we will be looking at. And it says in verse 20, my son, be attentive to my words, incline your ear to my sayings. Notice here, the first thing that is mentioned is to be attentive, to listen, to pay attention. My wife's a school teacher. She teaches English. And one of the things that she always says, she says to the students, always pay attention. Listen to the instructions. And still she has some that they'll come along and they haven't paid attention to what the instructions were. And they may have answered the question right, but they didn't put it in the right place, or they didn't mark the right place or whatever. And many times they have errors, not because they didn't know, but they didn't do it according to the way it was prescribed. In other words, we must pay attention, be attentive. And here it is vital. He says, son, this is like a father teaching his son. In fact, I can just hear my own father right now, that he would say to me as he would go through the Proverbs with me when he was taking me to school, or some occasion when we would be together, and he'd bring up a proverb because he knew the Bible so well, and he could just simply say to me, son, pay attention. Listen to what this says. And notice it says, let them not escape from your sight. Keep them within your heart. For they are life to those who find them and healing to all their flesh. And then this is the verse I want you to see. Keep your heart with all vigilance, for from it flow the springs of life. Now I want to make this very clear. Here he's talking about the most essential thing that goes on in your life. And you know what that is? It has to do with your heart. Now, I'm not talking about our physical heart, obviously. He's talking about our heart in the sense of our very essence, who we are. Now, every one of us have what we call a self-consciousness. We know about ourselves. We have within our mind, there are things that we think about, there are thoughts that we have. Sometimes we may be thoughtless, and we might be daydreaming or whatever it is, but we are thinking, and when you're awake, that's pretty much what you're doing. You have this thought process. But also you have a will. You determine to do things. You determine to do something either physically or mentally, or I would say even spiritually. And then we also know that we're made up of affections. There is man in terms of his affections, things that he's drawn to, things that he loves. There are things that he hates. And then there are also the sort of things that we see, that man, he also has a sense in which he doesn't follow in terms of doing what is right, but he does that which is wrong. He has a nature. Now, when we talk about the heart of man, we're talking about all of his faculties. Heart, mind, I would say soul. We would talk about the fact that there is the exercise of our will and our affections, and there is also our understanding. So when it talks about the heart here, it's talking about who we are, the very essence of who you are. Now, why did God bring you into this world? I'm not even going to go to the question, do you think that God had anything to do with you coming into this world? I know this, that every one of us are here, and if you want to argue with whether God is involved or not, that's all right. You go ahead and argue that. I'm just simply stating, I believe what is in the scriptures and what is obvious, that we are creatures. We're created in a certain way, and we're extraordinary creatures. We're nothing like animals. We're nothing like any other thing that was created. Man is unique. God gave to us this ability. In fact, he placed Adam in the garden after he created Adam and then created Eve. And they were placed in the garden, and there he named the animals. He was it had dominion over that until he fell, until he sinned. Because man was a creature that God endowed with certain things. And he had mental capacity, he had affections, and he had a will. But because of the fall, he has a nature that's like his father Adam. And we have to remember that. Romans chapter 5 points to that very clear, that man in his very nature is that it's by one man's sin, that is Adam, when he sinned, he plunged all of mankind into the state and condition of sin. All are born with sinful natures. None get by that. It says that we sin in terms of as the sparks fly upward. Say man has trouble in this world because he has a nature that is sinful. And all the things that we see that happen, that comes from that sinful nature. But what God does in regeneration and with the coming of conversion is that he gives grace, and what he does is he gives a new heart. He takes out the heart of stone and gives a heart of flesh, and man becomes a new creation in Christ Jesus. But it's still necessary for us to keep our own heart. Notice what it says here. Keep your heart with all vigilance, or as it says in the King James, with all diligence. Now, those words are saying here that we need to guard, we need to fortify, we need to have a fortress in which we are keeping and watching over our heart. Why? Because out of it are the very issues of life. You see, a man is what he is in his heart. That's why men sin, because they have a sinful nature and they have a sinful heart. Remember, it's recorded for us that the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? Do you realize what it's saying there is that you can't even know your own heart? We don't have the ability in and of ourselves, because our heart in its very essence is corrupt, and therefore we need a new nature. Excuse me. But now, what God does is he creates within us a new nature. That's what it talks about in John chapter 3. And Nicodemus and Jesus said to him, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, unless you are born again, you cannot see the kingdom of God." And he says elsewhere, he said, "If you cannot enter into the kingdom of God." In other words, there must be a change that takes place, and that change is we're given a new nature. We're actually given a new heart. And that's what makes the change. But listen to what else it says. "Keep your heart with all vigilance, for from it flow the springs of life," are the issues of life. So the various things that happen in your life really come from your very heart. Now, what does it mean to keep your heart? Well, first of all, we must know that we've come to know Christ and we're in Christ Jesus. If you're not in Christ Jesus, we're not talking about anything that man can do. You can't keep your heart. I was listening to a radio program today by Charles Swindle, Chuck Swindle, and he was talking about the very thing of sexual purity. And in the program, he was talking about the fact that what happens in terms of men when they are tempted. In other words, they attend to certain fantasies and they begin to think a certain way, and then it grows into something else, either fantasizing about an encounter or they actually do have an encounter and it becomes full-blown sin. But it starts in the very mind and in the heart of a person as they begin to think and fantasize, and what happens is lust takes over. He was saying, and I believe this is so very true, well, a man can think about, well, I would never do that. I would never want to bring shame upon my family. I would never want to hurt my wife or my children. But you know, I've counseled people to the point that they've become so involved with someone, they don't think about their family anymore. They don't think about what it will do and how it will hurt so many people. That's not the only thing that can keep one from sinning is God himself. He is the one that controls in terms of giving us a mind and a heart to please God. He gave an illustration in which he was telling about flying on a plane, and he was going to a certain destination, and they stopped somewhere and they picked up some more passengers. And he said of this one man that was sitting behind him, he was rendezvousing with his mistress, and she gets on the plane and they were sitting behind him, and he said, "I did eavesdrop, but I heard them talking about their encounter and how wonderful it was going to be, and talking about the excitement of the next couple of days that they were going to be having, and that their spouses didn't even know about it, and somehow it heightened their excitement." You see, what happens is the heart of man is deceitful. You see, you must be guarded. Now, what I'm telling you is this is something that everyone must think about. Keep your heart, it says, with all vigilance. What is that? Oh, be attentive. Watch over it. Look. Be guarded. Careful. Care for what you see, what you act. Guard your eyes. In fact, if we had time, I would read on. It talks about guarding our eyes and our ears and and our lips and what we say. Because what takes place is man will begin to take what the devil puts before him, and he will fantasize upon that until it comes into full bloom. James speaks of this, about sin, and how it's just like a child that's conceived, and then it comes and it has full, it's born, it grows. And what he's saying is that our sin will grow, and it will grow, and it will come to full fruition, and it will be sin. And so we must be guarded about that. And he says for us to keep our hearts with all vigilance. Be guarded, my friend. Watchful. You see, the reason I'm even speaking to you today about this is because this is what the Bible tells us that we must do. You never get to the place, Christian friend, if you think that you can make it without seeking God, without studying His Word, memorizing His Word, without prayer, without the meeting of the church, the family of God. Let me tell you, the church is very important. In fact, that's what Jesus came to die for, is His church. And so you need the church. I encourage you to seek God. Let's bow in prayer. Father, I thank You today for the grace of God that is extended to us through Jesus Christ, that He came in this world to die in the place of sinners. He shows grace and mercy to us. I pray, Father, that we would now be conscious to keep our hearts with all vigilance. Be very careful and guarded. May we pay attention to those things that we do and say, that it might be to the praise of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Thank you for being with us today. We're going to be beginning a new year, so it's time for you to once again start anew. We fail, but we get up and we go again. Start reading the Scriptures and studying the Word of God. I encourage you. This is brought to you by Kinsey Drive Baptist Church. The address is 2626 Kinsey Drive, and that's Dalton. And you can call on 706-277-3505. Until next week at this same time and same station, may God richly bless you.
He is robed in majesty. The Lord is robed in majesty and is armed with strength. Your throne was established long ago. You are from all eternity. The seas have lifted up, O Lord. The seas have lifted up their voice. The seas have lifted up their pounding waves. Mightier than the thunder of the great waters,